celebrate as Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem as the Lord and the Savior. You know, people came out in multitudes on this day to worship him on the streets by putting their cloaks and palm leaves on the road. This week is also known as Passion Week, a week that led to Christ's agonizing journey to crucifixion and resurrection. So today, I want you all to take a walk with me into the history to the very same day this has happened. Let's visualize. Now, imagine, I'm just setting the background. Imagine you are with the people who have came to Jerusalem as it was a tradition to celebrate the Passover where you belong to. So you are one of them. The news of Lazarus being brought back to life, you have just heard it. And now you hear that Jesus is entering into Jerusalem. So just see the excitement that is building among the people. And imagine you are with them. And as Sarita read for us from Matthew chapter 21, from verse till 12, verse 1 till 12, but we'll jump directly to verse 7. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Other cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitude who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? And so the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. And now, you know, palm branch is a symbol of Jewish triumph and victory, as it is referred in Leviticus chapter 23, verse 40, and also in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. And spreading of cloak, of clothes, was a customary way of announcing the arrival of the king, as we read it in 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 13. Now, just imagine the scenario, and if you want to just see the multitude, imagine how we all went on to the street when we heard India won the World Cup. The street were full of people rejoicing, shouting. And now multiply that joy, that shout, 100 times on the street of Jerusalem. People were together shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. You know, they were reciting Psalm 118, 25 and 26. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Now, in the Old Testament, Hosanna is often referred as save us now in Hebrews. So people were crying out to the Son of David to save them. They were expecting that Jesus is returning as the rightful king of Israel, defeating the Romans and take the throne forever. That was their expectation. Hosanna is also referred as praise God, as we see it evolving in New Testament. You know, and Jesus was being hailed as King and Messiah and being worshipped as he was entering Jerusalem. And I want to read from Luke chapter 19, verse 37 and 38. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they have seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Imagine, he was being praised, he was being hailed as a King and Messiah. And now as the people are rejoicing, they are putting their cloak, the palm branches as he arrives, and those people who are following behind him, let's leave Jesus, his disciples, and the people of Jerusalem to celebrate triumphal return of Jesus. And let us come back now to this very day into the comfort of your zone as you're listening to this online message and wonder, what does the Jesus triumphal entry into Jerusalem mean to us today? Does it mean same as it meant to those in Israel that time? Or does it mean even far greater? And to answer that question, I have drawn some parallelism between then and now. And I put that into four major points. The first point, people were crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, save us. They were expecting for Jesus to save them. But for us today, in this time, we are already saved. Jesus has redeemed our life on the cross. He is our Savior. He has saved us already. As it says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. We are redeemed. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says, God demonstrates His own love for us in this, while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. The Save Us, Save Us cries from then is already a Savior for us. Point two, people were expecting the King of Israel, the King of Jew, who would come and take the throne forever. That was their understanding and expectation. But as for us in now, today's kingdom, He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords over all the creatures of the earth. He is no more simply the God of Israel. He is no more simply the God of Jews. He is the God of Jews and God of Gentiles. He is the God of all creature. Now, amazing. Point three, you know, people at that time laid down their cloaks and palm leaves to acknowledge Jesus as the rightful King and welcome Him. But in today's time, we need to acknowledge, in order to acknowledge and welcome Him, we need to lay down our hearts in obedience to His will. So in today's time, if you want to welcome Him, welcome the rightful King, you need to lay down your hearts in obedience to His will. We need to offer our lives to Him. And as it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, that is your true and proper worship. We need to offer our lives unto Him. That is the right to worship now. And at four, at that time, that's my point four, Jesus came riding on a donkey. He shows meekness, humility. But in our times, he will no more return riding a donkey, but instead he will return gloriously as a mighty warrior riding on a fiery white horse with authority of King of Kings and Lord of Lords, doing the rightful judgment as mentioned in Revelation chapter 19 verse 11. And it says, "Then I saw heaven opened, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war." Amen. So in conclusion, the triumphal return of Jesus in Jerusalem, as it was for Israelite, it is much more for us in today's time. The Israelite had no idea that Jesus' return has put into action God's greatest plan that would change the fate of humanity forever. They had no clue. We here now, we can see that. We can attest to that. The victorious return for us is more than just return of the King of Israel or King of Jew. It's the return of the King of heaven and earth. It's the return of the King of all creatures. Now comes my appeal. We know this fact. The Christian worldwide know this fact. But the world out there, they don't know. They don't know this story, his story. And they need to know the story of good news. You know, the world today, if you see out from the last 2 weeks, we've been seeing getting confined to a home. The world today is crying out, "Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, oh God." They are crying out for saving from healing and protection from COVID-19. They are crying out for sickness, loneliness, poverty, bad relationship, health problem. The world out today is crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, save us." And they need to know, the world today need to know that Jesus can save them, not only from the earthly issues, but mainly from the eternal destruction. It is our job, our mandate, our great mission to share this good news with the world, because the time is up. The time is now. And as Jesus has commanded us in Mark 16 verse 15, "Go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone, to everyone." So the celebration of his triumphal entry in today has much more meaning, much more importance, and a greater need for the world to know that Jesus is the answer. And today, as we sit after 2,000 years later on this Sunday, let us also worship the true God. Let us welcome him as a King and as a Lord over our life.